flow metrics are great. I'm a big proponent of cycle time, limiting WIP, tracking the age of your work, and forecasting with Monte Carlo Simulation. Links to those videos in the description below. But what happens when you calculate all of this, but the resulting data and forecast you see simply isn't good enough? Well, the good news is that at least you now know you've got a problem, but where do you start? Let's talk about it. So, let's say after you've calculated your individual cycle time for stories at the 85th percentile and it comes out at something like 14 days, it's not good enough for you. Or perhaps you run Monte Carlo simulation and it's telling you that it's going to take you 2 months to deliver 25 stories and that's not good enough for you either. What can you do? Well, one approach is to calculate your flow efficiency. Now, the factors that affect cycle time and Monte Carlo forecasts can be broken down into two basic parts, active time and inactive time. Active time is the time you actually spend working on a story. Inactive time is everything else. So we want to minimize inactive time and maximize active time. Now, flow efficiency is a simple calculation of these two variables, which you can see on screen now. Flow efficiency equals active time divided by cycle time. Now, before I go on, there are many that would say that you shouldn't bother with flow efficiency for three main reasons. First is that it can be difficult to calculate. The second is that even when you have calculated it, it doesn't provide you with anything actionable, i.e. it doesn't tell you exactly what the problem is. And the third is that there are far better metrics to focus on. Well, firstly, it's not really difficult to calculate at all, as we will see shortly. Secondly, it's true that it doesn't pinpoint the exact problem, but it definitely exposes a serious issue, visualizing it, and helps you to set up a series of interventions to reduce the problem, which is very often things like bottlenecks, handoffs, and queues, all of which kill our cycle time. And thirdly, there are better metrics to focus on. Well, yes, that is true. Cycle time, work item age, and forecasting with Monte Carlo. But when you first start using these metrics and the results you're seeing aren't good enough, what do you do then? Well, you can use flow efficiency to help you identify problem areas. So let's dive into flow efficiency. So how do we get the data needed in order to calculate flow efficiency? Well, you need to use wait states or inactive states in your workflow. I'd recommend creating dedicated wait states as columns, such as development done or ready for test. In this example from Jira, you can see the workflow states to do, blocked on hold, in development, ready for testing, in test, and done. In my example here, the cycle time starts only when a story first enters development and ends when the story enters done. Right, so we want to find our active time. So we're going to exclude to do because when a story is in to do, we're not actually working on it. It's basically queued up ready to pick when we have capacity. We'll also exclude any time a story spends in blocked on hold because this is also an inactive state. But a quick word on the blocked workflow state. Now, you need specific policies on this. Don't move items to this state just for any old reason. You also need to know what action you're going to take when something enters this state, otherwise it will just become a dumping ground. Okay, so we'll exclude ready for testing because this is a wait state, waiting for someone to pick up and test. And we'll also exclude done because when a story enters done, we're not working on it anymore because, oh, it's finished. So the first thing you're going to need to do is identify what wait states you're going to need for your workflow. Wait states are very useful, especially when you view your aging work in progress chart, as you'll be able to see where a story is in your workflow. And to find out more about aging work in progress charts, check this video out. Now, we just need to add up all of the time the story spends in our active states. In this example here, it would be in development and in test. Now, the data for this is automatically getting tracked by whatever agile tool you're using in the background. You simply need to extract it. If you're using Jira, check out the video on screen now to see how you can do it. But the principle is the same no matter what tool you're using. But briefly, you can get this data with plugins like Time in Status or EasyBI, or by using things like Script Runner. You can actually do it natively in Jira, but you'll need to use custom fields and automation rules. Check out the description below for ideas on that. Now, it should go without saying that everyone on the team must take full responsibility for their stories and move them to the correct state at the right time. Now, you should already be doing this anyway if you're tracking your cycle time and actually care about it. Now, team members only need to do this once a day and it only takes a few seconds. If you're a Scrum Master or team lead, you'll need to explain to the team why it benefits them. It's in their own interest and that of the teams to do this, because it's ultimately going to help everyone work in a more efficient and sustainable way, meaning they won't get landed with lots of fixed scope, fixed time work, having to work long hours and weekends towards the end of large pieces of work just to get it completed. And they'll have less stress and better well-being because of this. So why is this? Well, because they'll be able to provide accurate forecasts to leadership really come true, so trust will be built. And all they have to do is update their board once a day. It's a small price to pay. Now, If you've never measured cycle time before, or you're finding that your cycle times are very high, then it's not uncommon to find that your flow efficiency is also low, around the 10% mark. Let's examine that. Now, if we took 10 days to complete a story, that's your cycle time, but the active time, the time you actually spent working on it, was just one day, and that means 9 days were spent when essentially nothing was happening. That is your inactive time. Now remember, to calculate your flow efficiency, you need to divide your active time by your cycle time. So in this case, 1 divided by 10, which is a flow efficiency of 10%. Where do you think you should focus your effort in this example? Exactly. You need to focus on getting that inactive time down. So let's take this a little bit further. Let's say that your 85th percentile for your process is 20 days, meaning you've got the cycle times of all your previously completed stories, and you've used Excel's percentile function to calculate the 85th percentile. Now, to calculate your flow efficiency for all previously completed stories, simply sum up all of the active time for each story and divide it by the total cycle time for the same stories. In this example here, you can see that the flow efficiency of our process is 10%. Now, a low flow efficiency means we've got a lot of inactive time, and a high flow efficiency means we've got a lot of active time. Now, if you aggressively go after that inactive time in our example and manage to reduce it significantly and end up getting your flow efficiency to 50% while keeping your active time the same, that would mean that your 85th percentile would be 5 days instead of 20. Much, much better. Now, if you'd like to take a closer look at this Excel sheet, I'll leave a link to it in the description below. Now, if your flow efficiency is 70%, then a better strategy would be to target the active time spent on stories, since this makes up the majority of the cycle time. Now, flow efficiency doesn't tell you exactly what the problem is, as its detractors have pointed out, but it points you in the right direction. It's a starting point. And the reasons for high or low flow efficiency could be many. For example, your stories are too large, they're too complex, so break them down. And maybe you haven't refined the work prior to taking it into sprint and didn't discover any dependencies or constraints. Or perhaps it's nothing specifically wrong with the story, but you're trying to work on too many things at the same time. So limit your work in progress and reduce your context switching. Now start by putting a WIP limit on your in progress column and stick to it, don't ignore it. Or perhaps you've got some process issues causing decision latency. Maybe your stakeholders or product owner aren't as engaged as they could be, so try and build better relationships. And obviously, when a story goes into blocked on hold, don't ignore it. Do whatever it takes to get that story back on track. But perhaps the biggest offender is very often bottlenecks, handoffs, and queues. Are you waiting for something to happen? A stakeholder or a committee maybe, or a colleague needs to pick up the story and do something with it. Testing, for example. Identifying these queues and removing them is one of the cheapest ways of increasing your flow. Now, flow efficiency is a great way to start troubleshooting while your cycle times are too high. For a more detailed look at flow metrics, check this video out. It explains what they all are, how they help, and how to start. Okay, that is it for this one. Thank you very much for watching. I really do appreciate it. Stay safe, stay humble, and I'll see you next Thursday for another Agile Thought.